मॉर्निंग चिल्ड्रन, साइरा, वेलकम टू पार्ट 5 ऑफ हिस्ट्री चैप्टर 4, दैट इज़ द मुगल एम्पायर. दिस इज़ द लास्ट पार्ट, रदर लास्ट रिविजन पार्ट ऑफ दिस चैप्टर. सो एज ऑलवेज आई वॉन्ट यू ऑल टू बी रेडी विथ योर नोट पैड एंड अ पेन टू जॉट डाउन द इम्पॉर्टेंट पॉइंट्स इफ एनी. So basically, throughout this revision session, I have also discussed about the map from this chapter, right? So requesting you all to practice it properly and start learning if you haven't started yet with SS. Okay. So yes, in the last video, we had discussed about a closer look of Akbar's policies and Akbar and religion, right? So basically we discussed about the broad features of administration laid down by Akbar, okay, and elaborately discussed by Abul Fazl. He had written in his book Akbarnama, okay, and in the last book or the last volume of the book was named as Ain e Akbari. Then when we discussed about Akbar and religion, we saw that while Akbar was at Fatehpur Sikri during the 1570s, he started discussion on religion with the ulama, brahmanas, Jesuit priests who were Roman Catholics and Zoroastrians. All these discussions took place in the Ibadat Khana. Akbar realized that religious scholars who emphasize rituals and dogma were often bygods. I have explained the meaning of by gods and dogma in the last session. Then we discuss about the teachings which created divisions and disharmony amongst the subject. So thus Akbar accepted the idea of sul-e-kul or universal peace, right? Now in this particular video session we are going to see a new topic, that is Mughal Empire in the 17th century and after. Children, the administrative and military efficiency of the Mughal Empire led to great economic and commercial prosperity. International travelers describe it as the fabled land of wealth. But then these same visitors were also appalled at the state of poverty that existed side by side with a greatest opulence. So children, here opulence means great wealth or luxuriousness, okay? The inequalities were glaring. Documents from the 12th year of Shah Jahan's reign inform us that the highest ranking mansabdars were only 445 in number out of the total of 8,000. This small number, that is mere 5.6% of the total numbers of mansabdar, received 61.5% of the total estimated revenue. They received it as salaries for themselves and their troopers. Yeah, so just as I said, the international travelers described it as the fabled land of wealth. The Mughal emperors and their mansabdars spent a great deal of their income on salaries and goods. So this expenditure benefited the artisans and peasantry who supplied them with good and produce. The huge scale of revenue collections from the primary producer, that is the peasant and the artisan, left very little for them to invest. So, as I said, the Mughal emperors and the Mansabdars spent a great deal of income on goods and salaries. This benefited the artisans and the peasantry who supplied them with goods and produce. But then again, what happened was the revenue scale, okay, of collection left very little for the investment in the hands of primary producers, that is the peasants and the artisans. This we have seen. The poorest amongst them. So, as I said, the Mughal emperors and the Mansabdars spent a great deal of income on goods and salaries. This benefited the artisans and the peasantry who supplied them with goods and produce. But then again, what happened was the revenue scale, okay, of collection left very little for the investment in the hands of primary producers, that is the peasants and the artisans. This we have seen. So, what happened was the poorest among them lived from hand to mouth and they could hardly consider investing in additional resources like tools, supplies, or to increase the productivity. The wealthier peasantry and artisanal groups, the merchants and the bankers, profited in this economic world. So, what happened was the huge amount of wealth and resources, okay, which was under the, or rather commanded by the Mughal elite, made them extremely powerful group of people, okay, in the late 17th century. As the authority of Mughal emperor declined, his servants emerged as powerful centers of power in the regions. They constituted some dynasties and held command of provinces like Hyderabad and Awadh. Although they continued to recognize the Mughal emperor in Delhi as their master, by the 18th century, the provinces of the empire had consolidated their independent political identities. So, children, basically what happened that time was the poor peasants could not invest in additional resources, okay, and the wealthier peasantry and artisanal groups, that is the merchants, bankers, etc., they profited in this economic world. The huge amount of wealth and resources which were under the Mughal elite, it made them very, very powerful group of people. And this happened in the late 17th century. So, with the decline of the Mughal emperor, their servants emerged as a powerful centers of power in some of the regions. And they constituted new dynasties and held command of provinces like the Hyderabad and the Awadh. Now, children, just like in previous videos, I'll be conducting Q&A session, that is question and answer session, okay? So, first question, how were the debates with religious scholars important in the formation of Akbar's idea of governance? You can start the answer this way. During the 1570s, Akbar had a discussion on religion with the ulama, brahmanas, Jesuit priests who were Roman Catholics and Zoroastrians. Now, these discussions took place during his stay at Fatehpur Sikri in the Ibadat Khana. Akbar was interested in the religion and social customs of different people, and his interaction with people of different faiths made him realize that their teachings created divisions and disharmony amongst the subjects. Thus, Akbar came up with an idea known as Sul Ekul, which focused on the system of ethics, honesty, justice and peace. Abul Fazl helped Akbar in framing a vision of governance around these ideas of Sul Ekul, and it was also followed by Jahangir and Shah Jahan. So you need to cover these points as well. Again, for your information, just to remind you, this exam is going to be MCQ based, right? The next exam that you will be having, the final exam you will be having, will be mostly MCQ based only. But according to the scenario, like how it goes and how we get the permission to start the school and all, henceforth in the coming years when you will have written exams, you should know how to write the answers. So for that, I'm just telling you that when you get a question, always look for the marks allotted to it, and according to the marks allotted, write the answers. Okay, so if it is 2 marks question, at least 2 points should be there. 3 marks question, at least 3 points should be there, right? 3 proper valid points. Yes. So let us move on now to the next question. How important was the income from the land avenue to the stability of the Mughal Empire? So let us answer it this way. The income from the land revenue played an important role in establishing stability in the Mughal Empire. It strengthened the economic system of the empire. The money collected was invested in building forts and was for the welfare of the subjects. So, how its importance can be easily assessed from the fact that Todarmal, Akbar's revenue minister, took a 10-year period to carry out the proper calculation of the land revenue. So, children, with this, I end this part of the video. See you in the next video. Till then, goodbye and keep learning.